Black in Latin America by Henry Louis Gates Jr. with annotated commentaries and criticisms.
When you think of Mexico, what comes to mind? Endless sunshine, white sandy beaches, the Mayan and Aztec ruins, and Peru? Machu Picchu, the great Inca people, 5,000 varieties of potato. How many of us realize that far more slaves came to Mexico and Peru together than came to the United States in the entire history of the slave trade? I've come here to search for the lost history of black people in Mexico and Peru. The charming town of Tlacotalpan was founded by the Spanish in the 16th century, but it boomed in the 18th century when it became a major trading center for sugar, cotton, cattle, and horses, all commodities produced by slaves, Indians, and mestizos. Today, Tlacotalpan is known for its fandangos, music and dance that combines Spanish, indigenous, and African traditions. Fandangos are a fitting metaphor for the African roots of Mexican culture.
The fandango. Those girls are great. Now, the boys dance or just girls?
Well, they always say that the first hour for it, you know, like, watch the girls. Check if you want to dance with one of them later.
Rafael Figueroa, an ethnomusicologist, grew up here. He's an expert on this music, which he's heard since childhood.
Fandango, it's a really mix of Hispanic and African mainly. Even though it's Hispanic instruments, but they are played in a really percussive way, and they are playing, you know, against each other with the result of a big polyrhythm.
Polyrhythm. That's African.
Yes.
Not to discredit the West African contribution to Mexican music, because West African polyrhythmic cultures were also an influence, but percussive polyrhythm didn't just come from Africa, and if we are going to be even more specific, the African side didn't only come with the West African slaves. Apart from native Spanish traditions, Spain has two well-documented percussive polyrhythmic traditions that influenced Spanish music, even before the migrations to the Americas. That would be the Roma traditions that migrated all the way from India, that most know as Gypsy or Gitano, and the Middle Eastern and North African Berber traditions most know as Moro or Moor. Furthermore, it was not a combination of Hispanic and African music as the ethnomusicologist claims, but of Spanish, with all its prior syncretism, native, and African influences which resulted in this Hispanic music and dance tradition.
Thank you.
Fandango's ending around 6 or 7
a.m.
next afternoon.
I love this town.
What could be more Mexican than La Bamba? I remember singing the chorus along with Richie Valens on the radio. But I didn't know that the song was sung here as early as 1683 by Angolan and Congolese slaves. Like the fancy footwork called Zapateo, La Bamba is another example of Mexican culture's complex African origins, now blended into a rich, brown, ethnic mix.
Hey, bravo, bravo!
But since so many black slaves came to Mexico, why doesn't anyone around here look especially black?
They mixed from the beginning. That's why you cannot, you know, see them, but it's there.
So the blackness is diluted?
Yes. A lot of African elements are still present. We are darker than the rest of the Republic. Also, the way of talking, we have a specific accent.
Really?
Yeah.
Can you do it for me?
If you say helado, ice cream, here you would you drop the D, so it's helado. Or you drop the final S of some words. But it's really common among the people from African origin.
This is another misconception. Afro-descendants might do it as well. But one of the main reasons for these speech patterns is because of immigration from Andalusia. Translating from a Spanish textbook, the influence of Spanish of Andalusia on Cuba. The Spanish that is spoken in Cuba, like that of other countries in Hispanoamerica, has a pronunciation that is similar to that of Andalusia in the south of Spain. This is because many of the conquistadors that arrived to America were Andalusians. In Spanish from Cuba, like that of Andalusia, you omit consonants.
Cansao, cansado, caminao, caminado, profesora, profesora.
You don't pronounce the D in words like
verdad, verdad, ciudad, ciudad.
Another characteristic of Spanish from Andalusia is the S-ing, which consists of pronouncing the S, C, and Z the same way. These characteristics are also found in the Spanish of Cuba and Mexico.
I've noticed some people will say, buenos dias. Instead of Buenos Dias. And I thought, what's wrong with you? You know?
About an hour and a half from the Fandango's festive atmosphere sits the somber port of Veracruz, one of the main points of entry of Latin American slavery. Starting in 1535, virtually all of the commodities arriving in Mexico, including African slaves, were unloaded here.
It was called the key of New Spain, the port of San Juan de Ulua.
Judith Hernandez studies the archaeology of Veracruz, and Sagrario Cruz Carretero is a professor of anthropology at the University of Veracruz. Both are helping me imagine the arrival of hundreds of thousands of slaves through this very port.
How long did it take to get to Veracruz from the ports in Africa?
Some records mention 2 months.
That's a long time to be in a steam bath.
Right. And I found 20% of the load died. Mm.
And in the 16th and early 17th centuries, one out of every two slaves bound for the Americas disembarked in Mexico. In fact, in the year 1553, Viceroy Luis Velasco asked King Charles of Spain to curtail the trade, fearing an uprising, and with good reason. Until 1650, the number of blacks and mulattoes was roughly equal to the number of white people living here.
These are rings to which they tie their ships.
They're heavy.
The port didn't have a pier or docks. The ships arrived directly here.
What would happen when the slaves arrived? They would be checked medically?
There were paid surgeons to review the blacks. And the checkup consisted of licking the beard.
They lick there? That sounds nasty. Ah, why?
The sweat conserved salt. So if it was salty, that meant they had good blood pressure.
Mm-mm-mm. How much did the slaves cost?
From 150 pesos to 400.
Oh.
Let me compare. Okay. A house costs 400 pesos.
Oh, wow. So a slave and a house.
A luxury.
That's a lot.
It was a luxury.
Mm-hmm.
This is what the slaves would have seen first, after surviving the treacherous Middle Passage. Here they encountered a new country, a new language, and a new life as someone else's property.
These walls are covered with African blood because they were forced to construct this gorgeous building after the indigenous population decreased because illness. And they were forced to dive into the ocean and get these stones because they are made of coral.
Yes,
it's coral. And many of them died in this process. It's a history of death and a history of invisibility.
So this is the fingerprint of Black history in Mexico.
Right.
It's right here.
Right. Mm. Definitely.
Death and invisibility.
Professor Sagrario Cruz has invited me to lunch, promising me two significant clues to help me solve the mystery of Mexico's missing Black population.
This is my family. Well, I show some pictures to show you. And this is a very old picture, and this is my grandpa with his sons.
That's the banditos.
Yes. And this is the wedding of my parents.
Oh, look how pretty your mom is.
But he's a dark man.
She's light. So your family is part Black?
It's part Black. Mm. And it's something that was omitted until I was 19 years old.
How did you find out that you were part Black?
Because I traveled to Cuba. And when I arrived there, they started talking about the African heritage and the culture. I suddenly realized my family was Black.
This is a foolish concept she proposes. Culture is not ancestry. She definitely belongs to a Veracruzan culture that has African culture meshed into it. But so does anyone born into that culture, even if they migrated from somewhere else. If that is her only evidence that her parents have African ancestry, then she is living a pipe dream. Many non-Afro descendants live within Afro-Latino culture. I hope she did a bit of genealogy as well. Furthermore, even if she did have some remote Black ancestry, that would not make her family Black, as the rest of her ancestry was from somewhere else. They would be mestizos just like everyone else. Huh.
Because look like my grandpa, look like my father.
Yeah, no, they definitely look Black.
And when I started tasting the food, I said, oh my God, it's the food my grandma prepares at home. Huh. I recommend you to taste the mogo mogo.
That sounds
actually
African.
Yes, sounds African. Mm-hmm. And we have the same recipe in Puerto Rico. It's fufu.
In Ghana, fufu.
Right.
Fufu is like having a bowling ball in
right.
your belly.
It yes, like, yes. Mm. And in Cuba, it's called mofongo. And here we have fried yuca.
I love fried yuca. It's like a big French fry. But
right. This was originally prepared by slaves because mm-hmm. they needed carbohydrates.
Yeah, they had to work all day in the sun.
Right.
Mm. This is some good food.
How did it make you feel suddenly to discover you're Black?
Weird. It was like if you will be this, you will discover that you are adopted.
When you came back and told your family, did they tell you, you went loco up there, drinking too much rum?
I asked my grandpa, why you never told me we are Black? And he called my hand and told me, sweetie, we are not Black, we are morenos.
A moreno.
Of course he was aware that he was a Black man, but he rejected that identity.
That's interesting.
And I think this happens in most families, mm-hmm. that you hide the Black grandma in the closet.
The Black grandma in the closet.
Huh? Yeah.
In America, traditionally, if you had one drop of Black blood, you were Black. If the one drop were applied in Mexico, all of these people would be Black.
Almost 500 years separate the onset of the slave trade and rumors of Black grandmothers in a Mexican family's closet today. What happened in between? From the market in Veracruz, African slaves were taken to work in mines, sugarcane fields, and wealthy homes, but they didn't accept their fates passively. By the early 17th century, at least 10% had run away, forming independent settlements called palenques. The most famous runaway and rebel leader was a man named Yanga, the founder of this town, which is located a few hours inland from Veracruz. Carmen, who is Yanga?
A hero more than anything.
A Black slave.
Supposedly, he was a slave of the Spanish who broke the chains.
He freed himself from oppression that the Spanish had over him. And he also liberated the slaves.
What my girlfriend said.
That's why they call Yanga the first free town in the Americas.
Oh man, give me five, Gustavo, you're the man. You're a genius, you could be a professor.
In 1570, 50 years before the Mayflower landed at Plymouth Rock, Gaspar Yanga and several other men and women not only ran away from slavery, but spent 30 years hiding out in the mountains around Veracruz, attacking the Spanish in guerrilla raids and defending their community. The Spanish never could subdue them. Finally, in 1609, the Spanish admitted defeat and offered Yanga his own independent town in exchange for peace.
Nice narrative. Yanga and then De La Matosa led Maroon troops against the Spanish troops in guerrilla-style warfare. They did not defeat the Spanish, but did make it painful enough so that the Spanish would be willing to negotiate. A smart tactic. Yanga asked for a treaty akin to those that had settled hostilities between Indians and Spaniards, an area of self-rule, in return for tribute and promises to support the Spanish if they were attacked. In addition, he offered that the proposed district would return any slaves which might flee to it to soothe the Spaniards, that only Franciscan priests would tend to the people, and that Yanga's family would be granted the right of rule.
Yanga's settlement became what some scholars believe to be the very first town founded by free black people in all of the Americas.
Are most of the people around here black?
No.
Well, most people aren't completely black, but we are morenos.
Cultures, they combine together and form others.
So what are you? What are you?
Mestizos. Mestizos, because we are light brown.
Are you moreno? Are you moreno or no?
Look.
What are you, Indian?
I am black.
You're negra?
Sí.
You're a very beautiful negra.
Hernan Cortez, the famous Spanish conquistador, arrived in Veracruz in 1519. Then he headed to Mexico City, which the Aztecs called Tenochtitlan. One of his fellow conquistadors was a free black man named Juan Garrido. I'm following in his footsteps. Cortez was dazzled by the city's overall beauty, by its irrigation system, but especially by its gold. He brutally conquered it. Today, Mexico City is constructed on top of ancient Tenochtitlan. With over 21 million residents, it's the largest city in the Western Hemisphere. I've come here to find treasures too. But these are housed in the National Museum of Mexico.
So what are you taking me to see?
We are going to see the Casta paintings.
The Casta paintings.
By the end of the 17th century, interracial relationships were on the rise. The Catholic Church allowed marriage between all groups. The law granted freedom to the children of black slaves and indigenous women. White men increasingly impregnated black women.
They always begin with Spanish and Indian, that it makes mestizo.
Right.
Then mestizo and Spanish castiza.
Castiza.
The third one is castiza and Spanish, makes Spanish.
Maria Elisa Velazquez is a professor of history and anthropology. These 18th century Casta paintings were painted to show Europeans the diversity of the people here. These 16 images are a sort of an anthropological cookbook, showing the results of mixing the genes of black people, brown people, and white people.
What about me? Which one in the 16?
You will be here, look.
Let me see.
This one, a mulatto. The little kid, that's the mulatto.
The beautiful brown baby like me.
Yes, of course.
What would Barack Obama be?
Also a mulatto.
Okay, Beyonce, she would be mulatto?
Yes.
What would Tiger Wood be?
A lobo, with African descent blood and also indigenous blood.
These people were crazy.
Yes, they need pseudo-scientific reasons to explain why some cultures will be inferior and you have to make them slaves.
And they found it.
They found it.
16 shades of blackness.
Yes.
But why were your white people more willing to sleep with black people than my white people?
Quite well, because the culture of the Spanish church allowed the marriage between all the ethnic groups. And also the Spanish people have an heritage more open to the mixture because of the Arabic presence in Spain.
The Moors were in Spain for 800 years.
That's
or whatever.
Right. Yeah. So it was kind of easy to have these mixtures. And I think that's a different story from the United States.
By 1810, emboldened by the American Revolution and the French Revolution, Mexicans sought their own independence, but it would take time.
So the War of Independence, 1810-1821.
Yes, it was a very long war.
The revolution was started by a priest named Father Hidalgo. He called for the abolition of all castes, saying Indians, mulattoes, and other castes all will be known as Americans. After he was killed, his cause was taken up in succession by two generals, a priest named Jose Maria Morelos and Vicente Guerrero.
In fact, both were Afro-descendants.
Wait a minute. Two black people were generals in the War of Independence?
Yes.
So this is like George Washington being black.
Yes.
For Americans.
Yes, yes.
That's astonishing.
Yes.
After Morelos was killed by the Spanish in 1815, the Negro Guerrero, as his enemies mockingly called him, saw the war to its conclusion with the help of many black Mexicans. In one story, Guerrero's father beseeched him to surrender to the Spanish. In front of his men, he answered, "You are my father, but the country comes first." La patria es primero is now a famous phrase throughout Mexico.
Yes, and in fact, in 1830, Guerrero stopped slavery by writing the law in the Constitution.
33 years before Abraham Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation.
Yes. Also, an important thing about Guerrero is that he was the second president in Mexico.
So you had your Barack Obama in 1830.
That's right.
So once again, Mexico is ahead of the United States.
Yes, of course.
That's amazing. Yes.
Imagine if George Washington and John Adams had been African Americans. Would we have needed a civil rights movement? When Guerrero, who was a mulatto, abolished slavery, he also eliminated racial categories from birth, marriage, and death certificates. Today, there are states and towns all over Mexico named after Morelos and Guerrero. Morelos is even on the 50 peso bill. But many Mexicans don't even know that they were black men, or that they owe their independence to these two men of visible African descent. After almost a century of denying its multicultural and multiracial roots and an official policy of whitening, Mexico began to embrace a new national identity. In 1925, the philosopher José Vasconcelos published an electrifying essay called The Cosmic Race, arguing that Mexico's mixed-race heritage made it superior and unique. Almost overnight, Mexico's mestizaje culture became a popular brown pride movement. But if everyone was brown now, what had happened to Mexico's black roots? The blackest part of Mexico today is called the Costa Chica. It's on the Pacific coast, on the opposite side of the country from Veracruz. South of Acapulco and north of Puerto Escondido, the land is swampy and the towns are extremely poor. The Costa Chica has remained Mexico's blackest region for centuries because it was so isolated. There wasn't even a highway to get here until the 1950s. Born in Trinidad, Father Glenn Jamat has been ministering to congregations in the Costa Chica for the past 25 years. Part of Father Glenn's mission has been to raise black consciousness, even founding an annual conference of black towns. I wanted to learn from him how the Mexicans who can't pass as brown or cosmic relate to their blackness and their heritage of slavery.
The first occasion when I said a mass, a grown man came and he said, "Who are you?" And I said, "I am the priest." And for about 10 minutes, he went on, you're not a priest. You couldn't be a priest. I've never seen a black priest. We black people only work the land. We load trucks and whatever.
You can't be the head man.
Exactly. And he was really talking about himself. Mm-hmm. Everything is against an African Mexican seeing himself mm-hmm. as someone who can lift his head and take his place in Mexican society as an equal.
This isn't necessarily true. While colorism does exist in Mexico, classism plays a much larger role. Most of the Afro-indigenous populations of Costa Chica are very poor, and like other predominantly indigenous populations in the outskirts in Mexico, do not have the resources, education or contacts to climb the social ladder. In this sense, the people of Costa Chica are no worse off than other indigenous impoverished communities. In contrast, more urban Afro-descent people, while rarer, have had better luck in the social castes. Similarly, many Cubans who have migrated to Mexico, many Louisiana Creoles who fled from the U.S., all live much better lives than the people of Costa Chica as well.
Bamboleo del mar, de mi mar de cristal, rumores de brisa marina que llega a esconderse en mi verde palma. Bamboleo de mi mar, cabrillo de su luz, rumores de besos perdidos allá por la playa de mi Veracruz. Alma de Veracruz, alma de criollo, que cantas con la música del mar, que bailas con el ritmo de la siempre valiente, tu sangre por tus sueños a veces da. Tú naciste despreciando hasta la muerte, y ya que nadie jamás te vio llorar. Tú naciste despreciando hasta la muerte, y ya que nadie jamás te vio llorar.
A racial controversy in 2005 brought Mexico unwanted international attention. The Mexican government issued a commemorative stamp featuring the popular black cartoon character Memín Pingüín. Most Mexicans loved this character, but African Americans were incensed, calling it a racist throwback. Jesse Jackson even flew to Mexico City to complain about it personally to President Vicente Fox. The stamp became an instant collector's item, and the comic book was reissued from its first printing. The government never apologized and has never recalled the stamp.
Mem and Penguin. I mean, if you're sitting in Boston, you look at it, it looks like Sambo.
Mexicans who are very intelligent people, their reaction was, you cannot judge him by racist standards of the end of the century because it was based on the 1940s. So there's nothing wrong about Lemon Penguin. Mm-hmm. You sort of pinch yourself to say, well, is something wrong with me?
Free your mind, brother.
And you see the extent to which people have really bought into a system which is biased.
It is always interesting to hear Anglophone Afro-diasporic people try to understand the complexities of the Hispanic diaspora. A person from Trinidad and an African American aren't the best people to evaluate a comic book without even exploring context. Little context beforehand. Yolanda Vargas Dolce, the author, was a Mexican singer that went to sing in Cuba and fell in love with the Cubans. She was inspired by Cubans, not Afro-Mexicans, to write the Memín story. The name she gave Memín is important, as it was the nickname she had for her husband. She gave the character the same nickname as the love of her life. This was not an attempt to portray black people in an inferior light. It was an attempt to use the comic book medium to bring to light the qualities of black people and lessons of life in general through the experiences of a poor black Cuban child and his mother in Mexico. Back to the cartoon aspect of Memín. First and foremost, Memín is a cartoon, an exaggerated caricature of a human being. He is meant to be comic to entertain children. In this context, his features are no different than the exaggerated features of African-American produced cartoons like Fat Albert. Memín was first drawn much like a regular black child by the original artist Alberto Cabrera, but Yolanda wanted to win over more kids, so later she would ask the next artist, Sixto Valencia, to make Memín's features more exaggerated to be a more lovable character. This was simply a cartoonized version of a black boy, no different than the cartoonized version of Cantinflas, the famous Mexican comedian, or the cartoonized version of Sixto himself. For that matter, they both could be accused of looking like monkeys. There is a reason why in many places cartoons were called monitos, or Spanish for little monkeys, because cartoons are exaggerated caricatures of humans made to look like dolls or pets for children's entertainment. This was not an attempt at racial denigration, but an attempt at making the character dollish and lovable to the readers. That is why context is so important. If this was an attempt at making black people look like monkeys, why weren't all the other black people portrayed in the comic book also drawn like caricatures? In fact, the only cartoonized character was Memín. Memín's mother was painstakingly drawn to look more realistic like the rest of the characters, and so are all other black characters in the comic book. Many have accused Memín's mother of being a mammy, but Mexico did not go through American-style slavery nor Jim Crow, and did not have the mammy and pecanini images ingrained in their social conscience as negative images. The fact remains that those stereotypes were based off actual styles of clothing and people in the Afro-diaspora that exist to this day in many Afro-diasporic countries. While Aunt Jemima was modernized in the USA because many African-Americans saw a plump black woman in a headscarf as offensive, the fact remains that those women do exist to this day. Furthermore, the mother went through various stages in her character portrayal, and the comic even tackled taboo subjects like interracial love, where Memín's mom falls in love with a local man, or where Memín and his friends visit the USA during Jim Crow, and how his friends fight for him, or when Memín discovers that a slave ship has landed and he plots to free the slaves, or when Memín finds a white child, and Memín and his mother raise her as part of their family. Memín was a product of the 1940s, but it was way ahead of its time, touching taboo subjects and opening people's minds to the very mentalities espoused by the civil rights movement. Nor was this the only comic book Yolanda Vargas Dulce portrayed black people in. She had other successful comics which portrayed black people as heroes and masters of their own destinies. In fact, Memeen was so good at tackling subjects of civility and love of one's fellow man that the Philippines made it required reading in their schools. Maybe Yolanda was a bit naive, but racism was definitely not what drove the creation of Memeen. It was for her love of all people and her innate belief in the good of humanity that Yolanda Vargas Dulce created Memeen, and it is why it is one of the most beloved comic books in all of Latin America, not just Mexico.
Do you think in your experience they'll have a Barack Obama in this generation?
I don't think so. There's so much that has to be done before black Mexicans have access to education, political participation, social acceptance, and these things must be in place before you begin to produce leaders. Mm-hmm. I would also say that I have seen changes there. I now hear young people saying in a more assertive fashion, soy negro.
Why?
It is because of the kind of visibility we've been able to generate. Mm-hmm. And all the things that have spun off from that.
Hey, how you doing, brother? Eduardo, this place looks like Harlem to me. This looks like Africa, Mexico. It does, it's great.
But we speak Spanish, but we believe in the resurrected Christ. I mean, the Spanish culture, the European culture is also in us. And because of that, it's difficult to say we are only blacks. What are we? A mix? A mix, a mix.
Eduardo Zapata is a journalist, a native Costa Chican, and an example of the new generation Father Glenn mentioned, a generation proud of their black identity.
What have these people gathered to celebrate?
That one of them was ordained a priest. He makes many of the people here feel proud. The Toro de Petate is danced throughout all of America, from Argentina to Mexico.
The Toro de Petate dance celebrates the bull, which is part of most Latin American cultures. But when it's danced in Afro-Latino communities, the bull has a special significance. His valor becomes a metaphor for freedom from slavery.
Eduardo, are you described as a black person, a Negro here in Mexico?
Claro.
Of course. When you're little, nobody questions it. When you live here, when you go to Mexico City to study, you go to Acapulco, you go to the U.S., you realize you're different. Mm-hmm. That you're a Mexican, but you have something that's not the same as all Mexicans. You discover that you're black.
Do black people suffer discrimination here in Mexico?
Yes, we are a racist society. If you're in the cities, they stop you, ask you for your ID card, they make you sing the national anthem, and they could accuse you of coming from Cuba to destabilize things or something like that.
No se dice.
It isn't said, but in every Mexican family, there is a black person. And do you know what the city folks say? They say, he was born black, but we love him anyway.
Tell me about Memeen Penguin. Do you think it's racist or not?
No.
No.
Okay.
No. You go out into the street and ask people and they're not worried. It's just a character. They don't identify with him. He's still just in stories. It's kind of like laughing at yourself if you take it with humor and with sarcasm.
Why did Jesse Jackson come here to see Vicente Fox?
Jesse Jackson should have worried about all the blacks that go to work there and aren't treated like people. They're treated like third-class people. Because he's not interested in black people who are living. He's interested in Memeen Penguin. Politics.
Politica.
Si por negro me desprecias, yo no niego mi color, que entre perlas y diamantes el moreno es el mejor. En la noche me cobijo la sombra de mi color, no me importa lo que griten, este hombre trae sabor en mis venas.
Israel Reyes, a teacher in the Costa Chican town of Cuacue, is waging a campaign to promote Afro-Mexican pride. He hosts the radio show Cimarron, the voice of the Afro-Mestizos, which broadcasts bi-weekly throughout the Costa Chica. He's trying to force the country to recognize the rights of its black citizens.
The first step is being included in the census, to make it known that there are black people in Mexico. And those black people didn't get stuck in colonial times. And they aren't just in history books in the times of slavery. Blacks are here now, right now, today. And they are demanding that their rights be recognized.
Mm-hmm. Do you think your effort will be successful to change the census?
We started a process in which we had talks with government authorities. At the last minute, they inform us that it's not possible to include a question on the census, but we are pushing forward a pilot census for the black population in Mexico.
Oh, that's good. How will it benefit the black community if they can say Afro, Blanco, Indigenous?
The benefits would be public policies for these populations, better living conditions, education, health, housing, access to federal programs. If we don't start, we will never know how many blacks there are in Mexico.
Good luck. I think it's very, very important.
We are being visited today by a very well-known professor, Professor Gates. Professor, what do you hope the results of your work in the Costa Chica will be?
I hope that it makes Americans more aware of Mexico's complex racial past.
Mexico's black past didn't just disappear. It's still here, and in two forms. It's an essential part of the history, culture, and DNA of the country. But for some, it's written on their faces. The visible remnant of all that didn't melt in the mestizo melting pot that we call Mexico.
Mexico is a victim of its own success. It had a noble idea. It abolished slavery in 1830, 33 years before the United States did. But it had a romantic idea that if it eliminated racial categories, it would eliminate racism. But that was really a form of racism itself. You can't be great if you try to suppress a huge aspect of your history and a huge part of the identity of your people. If it looks like a duck, quacks like a duck, it's a duck.